I'm Qyiana.
And I'm Kadeja with ThisIsRnB.com. And we're here today with the one and only, the legend, the choir master himself, Ricky Dillard. What's up, hey, Ricky?
Baby. Hey, hey, hey. Y'all looking beautiful on that side.
You're looking good, too. Yes, thank you.
You are. So before we get into it, I want to first know, what does choir master mean? And how did that name come about for you?
Well, choir master means leader, leader of the choir. He's like Shananiah, who was given for song in the scripture. And he was known to be the leader. He dressed as the leader. He was different from the other singers. And he was skillful, as the scripture says. So I am like the Shananiah. Choir master has been given to me through the years. I had an earlier publicist, his name was Brandon, and he wrote his first biography or bio for us, as we would use it for what we were doing. And I noted that he had in the bio, the choir master, a term that I had never really used. And this was at least 20, 25 years ago. Mm-hmm. And I'm shocked to see it resonate today. I guess it kind of carried through the years from the old bios in the 90s. And I think some of that language just continued through the year, choir master within my bio. And it just flourished in the latter years, in the most recent years rather, to use it to my name. And then when the record label signed me, Motown signed me, we were on a call and they was like, let's call it the choir master. So I'm humbled that many think of me of that and they feel that I fit the shoe. I've been in it a long time, for over 45 years, and it is what I love to do, so I will take it.
Absolutely, choir master. You've been directed a junior choir at the age of 5.
Yes, ma'am.
If
yes,
that's not a choir master, I don't know what it is.
Right.
How did that happen at 5 years old? How do you
know? The funniest thing that you would bring up 5 years old, because after church on Sundays, my mother would come home, and we would come home as a family after church, and my mother would cook dinner. And that's all I would do is direct the walls, direct the curtains, direct the ornaments on the table. Make a choir, and my mother would say, come here, baby, direct for mama while I cook. And she would put on some old gospel, and I'd just be tearing it up. I'd be tearing it up, you know? So it's been my passion for a very, very long time. I was able to glean into the characters at our church who were choir directors, who were very animated, and they were grooving and getting it. And I think I just kind of took it from there, and it just became a part of who I am, as my mother continued for me to listen to really great, good choir music as a boy. It just carried on throughout the years, and I gained a love for it.
Okay. So who were some of your musical influences?
I had so many. If I might say, I was so humbled to sit under the tutelage of Dr. Maddie Moss Clark in 1980. It was my first United National Auxiliaries Convention, which at that time in the Church of God in Christ was called UNAC. It is called AIM now, but it was called UNAC. And it was when all of the singers from the church would sit under Dr. Clark and they would prepare an album called The Song Is Born. And, you know, throughout all those years, I was able to glean from her, Father Charles G. Hayes, Reverend Clay Evans, Reverend Milton Bronson, Reverend James Cleveland. These are all choir leaders of my young years, the institutional radio choir, just so many to name that really inspired me and also gave me an impartation of the choir that when I dreamed of my own, I knew what to do and how.
Wow. So going back to your household, and you say your mom would have you direct for her, I know you grew up in a religious household, but what type of religious was it? Was it like every church event type of religious household, Sunday school and vacation Bible study? Or was it like, you I see you on
you
Sunday?
Named it all. You named it all. We was in church all the time, but I'm thankful for it because it grounded me. But yes, my mother and my grandmother, who I remember much of, always took me to church. And my mother sang on the choir and then joined the usher board and then was the church mother. And then my grandmother was over the prayer band. She was the church mother as well before she died. She lived to be 101 years old. Oh, so, I mean, I had these ladies and these women who just reared and grounded me in church. And I was around that all the time until I became a church baby, you know, and was thinking church on my own. You didn't have to ask me to go to church. I'm ready to go to church. And that's just the way our household was. And we were a balanced house. We didn't just have gospel music in our house. We had all kinds of music in our house. But one of our main music was gospel music. And I'm so thankful that it is what has given me a career as of today.
Wow, that's awesome. So you talked about other music that you listened to. So who were some of your R&B favorites that you grew up listening to
I got many of those. James Brown. You talking about JB? JB was stanky, you know?
Right, right.
You're talking about, of course, the Queen, Aretha Franklin, whom when I was 5, 6, 7 years old, released an album with Reverend James Cleveland called Amazing Grace, and it was one of the first albums my mother bought was Amazing Grace. So Aretha and all her R&B stuff, you're talking about Gladys Knight, you're talking about Kool and the Gang, you're talking about man, you name it, Go-Go. we were on it. Bootsy Collins, George Clinton, you know. You know, it was the funk. It was the funk. And then moving into later years when hip-hop came aboard, you know, you're young, you end up going that route. And then you got house music, and you end up going that route. And then you got, it was just, I was all over the place musically. But I loved it because it allowed me to be able to hear what God has given me now to create the sound of Ricky Dillard. So I'm humbled by all of those beginnings.
Yeah. So you mentioned all the different genres of music, and you started off as a house DJ, right? House music DJ.
Well, I'm not a DJ, but I was one of the singers that did the music for the DJ. So we had more collaborations to work together. Many of the DJs became producers, to be honest. Mm-hmm. And we were their singers. And when they were ready to put tracks together for their shows and for their parties, they called us and we went in, put the vocals on what the beats they put together and the chords they put together, and we made music. So that's how really the house music thing came about for me, just living in Chicago, which is pretty much like between Chicago and New York. You know, you got that house, Studio 54s, and you talk about the just so many clubs out of New York that were great after Studio 54, the Paradise Garage, you know. Larry LeVan was the DJ. These were for y'all times.
So. Yeah, I was like, I don't know those people, but it seemed like it was a good time.
Well, let me tell you something. If you research those names, you're going to see how great these people. Frankie Knuckles was the father of house music out of Chicago. He had a club called Warehouse that when I was in high school, I snuck into. You understand? So those years made me dream about becoming a house music artist, and it was my first opportunity. Gospel said I was not ready, but house said, come on, we gonna sharpen you, and then once we sharpen you here, the gospel gonna take you. And house music has been a great beginning for me. I enjoy it.
So you started with the house, you know, secular music. Did you have any pushback when you did go into gospel music?
Most definitely. You know, back then in the 90s, 80s, 90s, you know, church people weren't for that. Nah, that's the devil's music. They didn't have a clue of the real true meaning of God's grace. And they preach what they were taught, to rebuke anything that to them felt like it was not of God. If you're twisting and turning and shaking, and it's not for God, you know? So we got a lot of pushback. I was even let go from my organization because I was doing house music. So I know the rejection part, I do. And I'm grateful for it because it taught me not to do those who would follow me like I had been done.
Wow. So what advice do you have for artists coming up now that are trying to live their life in today's time and also lead by example and live, you know, how the gospel, you know, wants them to live?
Well, I mean, you got to have some backbone yourself and some assurance that you have a relationship with God, especially if you do. If you have a relationship with God, he will speak to your heart. It is personal. Relationship is not between you, me, and them. It's between me and him. You understand? And when you know where you are, you make your call and election sure. When God has given you opportunity, you stand on that and you go for that. You have dreams. It's not their dream. It's your dream. If this is something you want to do, do what you want to do, and God will send those to shield and be around you, to push you, encourage you. While you hear the devils over here telling you not to, you got some angels over here saying, we with you. So, you know, I admonish any artist who has the dream to go after your dream and not the dreams of others or what others feel your dream should be. It is your dream. Live your dream.
Yeah, and you have to live. And you went, so you went from the house music, then you went to gospel.
And well, now, let me just say, I was never left gospel. I was always in church when I was doing house.
Yeah, you just tried something different.
I extended an opportunity to do something else alongside doing gospel because I was still good. I never stopped doing gospel from 5 years old, like you all were talking about. It's always been there.
And it never leaves you.
No. And I didn't leave it either because I stayed in church even while I went to the club.
Saturday night, made it clean up for Sunday, okay?
Listen, what they say it was sinful, well, let me just say, well, sin abounds, much more abounds is what the scripture said.
Right.
So fast forward back to your new album. Tell everybody about this new album.
The new album entitled ChoirMaster on the Motown Gospel label. I'm humbled to connect and be a part of the Motown family. You know, it's the funniest thing how things can be created in the process of something. We recorded this ChoirMaster album live in Chicago in September of 2019. And what I did was I went back to the original church that I recorded my very first album. It's called the Haven of Rest Baptist Church. When EJ Gaines and Monica Coates said that we want something small, we don't want to be big. We just wanted to be personal and very intimate. We went to the Haven of Rest Church where we recorded our first album and did this live session. It felt so good to not to have to be overpressured by thousands of people versus only 1,000 people or less. And it is a powerful record when they said that I could be myself, because for the last few albums before that, I felt pressured to have to be or sing songs that was not really my signature. And I'm speaking of praise and worship, contemporary, more secular sounding music. You know, I'm a churchy boy and I've always done it that way, but it challenged me to do other things. But ChoirMaster is dear to my heart because I was able to pull something that I felt was missing. I felt this sound of gospel was missing. I felt that everything we hear on radio or hear song these days is praise and worship. And I'm overwhelmed, but we like to sing songs that choirs like to sing. And that's what I tried to give through this ChoirMaster album. It is a powerful record, and little did I release it, it's coming out during a pandemic. And I didn't even know the songs in it would minister to the pandemic. And that was straight God. It was his orchestration. It was his direction. It was his preparing us to minister in a time when people would be home and would need to hear the message of the choir master ring.
Yes.
Then we put this EP together of those songs.
Yeah.
And took five songs that we felt people could dance and praise to and worship to their own way. Some folks come from the club. They might have left the club, but they just changed partners. They still dancing and juking the same way, but we dancing with God. Right. How about it? You can't beat it. You can't fight it. You might have a judgment of it, but hey, it's feel good music. It's happy music. If it's happy music, why y'all mad?
Right, right.
So here we are with the Choir Master album. I'm pleased with it. I'm humbled by it. And I'm grateful that it is blessing all generations of people, the young and the old.
We often hear of like R&B artists taking, pulling inspiration from gospel music. It's not too often that we hear the reverse, right? Can we just talk about Who Can I Run To? Like, that was very risky at that time. Let's get a little backstory on that one.
Who Can I Run To is a remake, actually. Another choir did that version that I did in the 70s.
Wow.
And or 80s, no, maybe 80s. And I always loved their version. And then when I got a deal and decided to record it on my second contract, which was Crystal Rose Records, I pulled it out and tried it. And I felt like it would be really relevant because of the 80s version of the R&B version. Now, the gospel version might have gotten some love. I'm not exactly sure how much love. It wasn't the single on their album or any of that. But I just took that song, put it on my record, put one of my strong leads on it. It resonated really well amongst the young, and especially those who remember the girl group that did it. So I love the fact of doing it, and I'm grateful. I'm glad that I did it because, like yourself, you remember it and you calling it out now. And I wouldn't even think about that song. I forgot about Who Can I Run To until you brought it up now. Haven't even listened to that song in a long time, but it was one of those chances that I felt it was proper time to release it. So I'm glad we did.
Okay. So out of your catalog, what is your favorite song? What song do you think has the most impact and had the most influence on your listeners?
You know, there's many. There's so many to even name one. But there is one song that is really testimony, and I did it on the Amazing album. I did a remake of it in a medley. It was called Things Will Work Out For Me, as the scripture says, for we know that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose, meaning that if the negative come, it's for your good. You will grow from it. You will be watered. No grass, trees, whatever grows without rain and without water. You gotta be watered in order to grow. And in everybody's life, a little rain must fall. And when you're in the storm, on the other side of the storm, it's gonna stop raining and you're gonna see a rainbow in the sky. So again, Things Will Work Out For Me was one of those songs. Through the 32 years of my ministry with UG, I've seen up and down. I've seen people come and go, great people leave that I didn't want to let go. They grew, they became pastors, they became they started their own ministries. Mm-hmm. And I had to let them go. Those were painful times. And then I've had some devils in the group try to tear the group up. Things work together for good. It is good that you had a Lorraine. So that would be one of my favorite tunes.
Let's talk about Sunday's Best. How do you feel seeing other people perform your hit songs.
I love it. It makes me know that I was on the right road and that the music has been effective and that my work has not been in vain. When I see that people are blessed by, whether it be old or new music, I'm humbled to hear songs sang on shows that people say, this blessed me. I want to sing this. I want to deliver this message to y'all. I'm really, really humbled. And I'm looking so forward to this Sunday's performance of Sunday Best. I've done the show a few times, but I'm humbled that they will call me in 2020. They're doing a choir show. And who better to have?
Than the choir master.
There you go.
Ow, what you want? Better.
I love it. Nobody better.
No choir ain't master. Nobody better. Can't nobody do that. They had Richard Smallwood on last week and we give our humble
thoughts
and respect.
Love him.
To the legendary.
Yes.
Richard Smallwood and his choir and singers. And to have me do the actual choir show is a blessing. So I'm thankful to Kirk Franklin, BET, and Sunday Best team for having Ricky Dillard come back again.
We are too. We can't wait. I can't wait to see the choir master.
Oh, trust me. We don't let
you. Oh, bring it. So Sunday Best, what does that platform mean? How important is a platform like Sunday Best for an aspiring gospel artist? I mean, if they had that when you were coming up, would you have auditioned to be on Sunday Best?
Absolutely, I would. I would have went up there, thought I was Leandra Johnson too. I would have won some. I would have won some flip flops too. I think the show is very relevant and it is needed because it helps us to search for who and to hold this gospel stage next. Ricky Dillard won't be here forever. Kirk Franklin won't be here forever, but we have to leave the torch in the right hands of those chosen for the main stage. Everybody don't have the main stage. You got some people who's supposed to be on the main stage. You got some people who's supposed to be across seas. Then you have some people who's supposed to do the local church. Then you have some folks who's supposed to be doing a community choir in the local community to bless the local community. Then you got some people supposed to sing in the prisons. You got some, everybody can't be on the main stage.
Right.
But we are looking for the Sunday Best to hold the mic, to carry gospel on. And I think it's very important for every contestant to know how important it is, how to grace the stage and how to come. You don't come like you're on in a storefront church. You gotta come like you at Carnegie Hall.
Right.
At Radio City Music Hall. Mm-hmm. And then you're telling these people, come to my show. And they're saying, why should we come? Because I'm good. Then they're going to tell you whether or not you're good. We're going to tell you that on Sunday Best.
Can you, we know that you've worked with Kanye West. Like, how did that whole thing come about and you helping him and, you know?
Well, let me just say, I and Kanye did not work together.
Oh, false news, fake news. All right, cool.
Okay, I understand because I posted our hangout, which is one of the Sunday services. I was invited to one of the Sunday services and I was in LA for the NAACP Image Award. And on Sunday, the music director of the samples told me in town, stop by. And I called him, I said, I'm in town, I'm gonna be here for Sunday. I wanna come to Sunday service. And I went to Sunday service and it was phenomenal. Kanye was there, the choir was there, the band was in strength, and they were in great performance. And many of the youngsters in the choir know Dr. Ricky Dillard and know the music. And many of them were from Chicago, my hometown. Their mothers sang in choirs and they sang my songs and their mothers would play my albums at their houses and their videos and the kids. So when I got there, they said, oh, Ricky Dillard here. And I was humbled by their love and Kanye's love to also have this choir movement in which I felt was needed.
Definitely.
He helped us to bring the needle back, bring the attention back that the choir is still relevant by how he put his own spin on the choir with giving these R&B songs, house music songs, or whatever to create this vibe that young people who probably thought choirs weren't, that's old.
Right.
But no, he brought it back to a place where it was so relevant that allowed the light to also be lit on many choirs who have been here for 20, 30 years or more. And we're having our day again. And I'm just so blessed to be a part of the choir move. I thank Kanye for, because his audience is bigger than ours. He's got the R&B kids. He got right. the secular
the
side.
The hip hop, yeah.
Yeah, he got hip hop, he got all of, and who else could make them see the choir?
Right.
And he did just that. And I'm grateful that he did that. And then also brought a lot of those, his fans over to where I'm at. And we're now in this big choir movement. And I'm so grateful that God used him to bring us back to that point.
I love the choir movement. Keep it going.
Me too. Me too. Did any of you sing in the choir?
Well, we did. We're actually sisters. But we're not gonna sing. Sing today. No, just
kidding. Soprano over there.
I think we got put out.
Soprano over there.
No, we got put out. We got put out.
We did not, okay?
I was a praise dancer.
Okay. But still.
I'm so shorty.
You're still in the worship department. You're still in the worship department. That's all we want. Don't want to lose no members.
Not losing any. No, for sure.
So what's next for you?
You know what? I really don't know what's next for me. Let me just say, every day, God gives us a new mercy, a new grace. I just wait to hear his inspiration, his direction. From today, we don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. We don't even know if we're going to be alive. But what I do say is that I am always available for the Lord's direction, for him to download in me what he wants me to do. And I am a vessel, and I'm going to do just that. I'm going to continue on the avenue of inspiring singers and preparing and sharpening singers for whatever their dreams are. They come here to start to sing, but being aboard this movement, they become other things: pastors, ministers of music, praise and worship leaders, politicians, husbands, wives. We built a lot of families out of New Jersey. A lot of brothers have found their wives in New G. A lot of wives have found their husbands. A lot of children were birthed in our music ministry. And we have people who started their own groups, started their business, started. I love the fact that the new generation ministries has been geared to empower, to uplift, to allow them to spring from this stage and create their own stages. And it has been a 32-year joy for me, and I wouldn't take it back. Before I take it back, I'll add more to it.
You know, with the times that we're in, you know, really uncertain, what is the message that you want to give to the people right now?
That in spite of what we're going through, we are coming out. We have to come out.
Right.
We don't serve a God who brings us this far. And then he said, oh, I'm tired. No. He did not bring us this far to leave us. And know that what he has done before, he will do it again. All we need to do is hold on and trust him and believe him, because we've seen him do it before. That he has not given us the spirit of fear, but he's given us power, love, and a sound mind. Use your power to get through now. Use your power to live and to get up each day. In spite we might have lost a loved one, get on up. And we must accept what God has allowed. We might lose some things. We might lose some jobs. We might lose some homes. But trust me, trouble don't last always. The sound mind, put on your mask. Wash your hands. You understand? Distance, social distance yourself. That's a sound mind. You know what to do. Don't nobody want to go home with COVID. Nobody right. want to die from it. Right. Let's do what we need to do to protect ourselves. And I will see you all on the other side of this. It's going to be all right.
Well said.
I need a daily inspirational book from you. Come on.
Seriously.
Okay. That passion burning in my heart.
moments with Choir Master.
Choir Master.
So where can people find you? For those that have been like under a rock, don't know where they can find the Choir Master, let them know, Mr. Ricky Dillard.
Well, you can find me on Instagram, Ricky Dillard, Twitter, Ricky Dillard, Facebook, Dr. Ricky Dillard. And then you can also find me on YouTube. I got a YouTube channel with all my videos from the Choir Master album. All the songs are there that you can watch from the actual performance in September in Chicago. TV, like and subscribe to it. And I'm also accepting, you know, virtual performance dates.
Okay.
You wanna call me to do something? Call me.
I love it. Oh my gosh.
Listen, we gotta keep living through this, because after this is our victory. You looking for me, I can be found. My number don't change. Call me.
I know,
me.
That's right.
Right now.
Daily deliverance from Dillard over here.
All right. I love it. I love
it. With my hands lifted up.
Hey. I love it.
Yes.
Thank you.
Well, we want to thank you. We have had a great time talking to you today. And I'm sure everybody who watches this is going to enjoy our interview with you. Very inspirational. Keep doing what you're doing, Choir Master.
Thank you all so much. For even choosing
to be
a part.
Thank you.
I'm humbled. It's nice to meet people that you've never met before, and you just have a great vibe, energy because of God, because of Christ. You feel the love. You feel what's in the heart.
Absolutely.
What comes from it, it reaches it. So y'all's love has reached my heart, and I'm so thankful for this opportunity.
Thank y'all again.
We must do it again.
Absolutely. Oh, we have your number now. You said it.
I was right.
You can't take it back.
No.
Nope. We got it. We're going to call you. And I want everybody to go out. What? Stream. What is Choir Master streaming? Download it. Listen to it.
All of that. Download
subscribe
it.
Subscribe on his YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram.
Yeah. Call it out. All of that is available for y'all if you're looking for me.
We love you. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
everybody, for watching. ThisIsRnB.com.